Hey, welcome again to another installment of the TriUnity series with Dr. Shmuel Asher. This is episode 4. We will probably thread through a lot of current events. We're recording this on the heels of the election debacle in the United States and the high strangeness going about in this whole election cycle. Obviously, some of the things that have leaked out over the course of the last month as a result of predominantly WikiLeaks, but also computer files that were found in Mr. Wiener's laptop have to do with issues that come right back into the whole TriUnity series, because what we're talking about on one level or another is spiritual sacrifice, human sacrifice, pedophilia, child sacrifice, and the culture of death that we live in. And with that, let's bring Shmuel in. Hey, Shmuel, how you doing?
How's it going, Randy? Good to be here again.
Shmuel, welcome back for episode 4. Having heard what I kind of introed there, we're going to kind of pull in some of the information that you've shared with me. The headline for this week, Trump wins over Janet Reno's death. You know, Janet Reno's dead body. Now, I got to tell you, this may have been one of these Mandela effect things. I would have sworn this woman died years ago, but I'm probably just mistaken.
That's funny you should bring that up, because when I heard that she just died, and they said it was from Parkinson's.
Yeah.
I thought maybe they sacrificed her. But I could have sworn, my first thought was I thought she already died a couple of years ago.
Okay, so I'm not the only one that thought that. All right, that's interesting.
I'm only remembering it that I thought it because you just said it. You know, but yeah, I thought that same thing, but maybe I was just hearing that she was very ill years ago. Maybe I'm misremembering. I'm not sure.
Well, memory's nothing very permeable, so we'll toss that out for the people that track Mandela effect. But yeah, it's interesting that it begins here a day before the election. Janet Reno, the first female attorney general of the United States, and the woman who, along with Hillary in the background, staged the Waco debacle, assumes room temperature, to use Rush Limbaugh's term. And this is in the midst of what you can just simply say is a complete shitstorm that has erupted with all of these disclosures around Hillary Clinton, leading to satanic worship, the pedophiles. All of this information's kind of been out there in the background for a long time, and I don't think it was an accident that it came out then. And then on the heels of that, the reopening, at least temporarily, this was bizarre as well, by the FBI, Comey, of the Clinton email server affair as a result of files found on Huma Abedin's husband, ex-husband, Mr. Wiener in New York, which seemed to have some very murky files on it as well. A huge trove of files that the FBI apparently was able to vet in less than a week, even though it took them a year and a half to do the original batch. So there's a lot of weirdness going on here.
Yeah, they went through 650,000 files in a week.
Yeah.
A special algorithm was, put, you know, lock them up in a skiff room or something and not go through them at all and just say that we went through them. That's what the algorithm was. But it, I don't know, we'll see what happens now. But it was pretty amazing. You know, you see all the stuff that was coming out about pedophiles, rape parties, blood sacrifices, and what really blew my mind, and I guess everyone that believes it, or, you know, that heard it and understands that they're proving it, that they know they have them, is that whole spirit cooking thing, which, you know, for me really hit home, especially because that's pretty much the whole train of teaching of my life. I mean, that's pretty much it. They no pun intended, boiled it down to spirit cooking of of these raped, sacrificed children and what they're doing. You know, some because my wife was asking me a certain thing. Why, you know, why would they do this? It's like different levels. They have proof that they have certain people. I think I even saw on one news show. They were showing artist renditions of two men that they knew were in Germany, I believe, and stole some children or a little girl out of a hotel in Germany. And they were exact. I mean, they were excellent renditions of wasn't Anthony Wiener, but I think it was Podesta and
Podesta.
Someone else. And
it's the Podesta Brothers. Yeah.
Yeah, and I was like, holy crap! Look at that. This, you know, and so. You know, you have different levels here. You have, you're freaking these kids out, these souls, all right? It's what they're doing is damaging the soul on purpose. So they're kidnapping the child, right? They're taken away from their parents. Then they're raping the kids at parties and whatnot. And then when that's all done with, after they've completely, you know, after the kid's damn near comatose, more than likely, they do a blood sacrifice, and then they finally cook the innards and drink the blood. All right? And so to that point, the reason this alleged spirit cooking thing is going on is because that's where they're gaining the most power after they've literally tortured that soul to the point where the next time it rotates back, if it does, I'm not even sure if the innocent are caught and brought back to the creator, or if they're allowed to rotate back in the system. I because you got to remember who they are. They're not exactly innocent. We call them innocent because they're children, but they're us, right? They're all the souls that have been here that have caused the problem to begin with. So at some point, like I've said in the book, they've consented originally. Whether they're 5 years old and now, and we see them as an innocent, yes, of course we do. But we're not connecting the fact that that soul is still the naive soul that made the choice to be there in the first place. So we have to always make that connection. But still, that's what they're doing. They're inflicting damage on these souls that carries through, and as it carries through to the next life, these souls come out in new children and new people, even more damaged, and that cycle continues to a point where then everybody's a narcissist, a sociopath at some point. But when I saw that spirit cooking, that really blew my mind. That because this is the antithesis of the most extreme. It's the most extreme result. Like I said in the notes I sent you, from souls that are continuing to ignore the everlasting agreement. They're continuing to ignore the truth, the correct way to continue through a life, or continue at all through all lives. And what we just saw with the WikiLeaks and all this stuff that they're confirming that these people are doing is the end result. And it can happen to anyone, any soul. The longer you stay in and the more they catch you, however they do in any life, the more chance you have to become like them. That is the fear. That is the you know, that's the deep hole here that people have to come to grips with, and why you have to return, why you have to get out. I mean, we look all the way back. You can see it from ancient times, like I was saying to you about Enoch. You know, we all know the script that those texts, you know, where he talks about when the souls of God, when the sons of God, souls of God, whatever you want to call it, you know, saw the children of men had beautiful women and came down and had children with them, and they created giants and whatnot, and they began to teach them all the sorcery and different things that we, you know, weren't supposed to know or utilize. And it goes through, you know, you look at that, those chapters in Enoch, and it gets to the point where they became pregnant, right? And they bore giants, right? And, you know, we really don't know how large they were, but there's all kinds of estimations out there, which really doesn't pertain to anything. And it says they consumed all the sustenance of men, and when men could no longer sustain them, the giants turned against the men and devoured mankind, and then they began to sin against the birds and the beasts and the reptiles and the fish and devour them in the flesh and drink the blood. But it's interesting, when you go into those texts, it says, then the accusation was laid against them as lawless ones. Then. All the stuff they did before that, okay, was not good, right? But it wasn't until the consumption of the flesh and the blood that the accusation of being lawless was laid against them. And I think that's important for people to understand from ancient times till today, because that's what you're seeing with these people that are doing these things. I don't know what's going on here. Like you said, there's a lot of weird stuff going on with the election, with what happened there. I can only imagine what was going on in the background. But with intelligence agencies going back and forth, a coup, counter coup, and all this other stuff. But it must have been pretty sporty for a while there. But it definitely goes to show you that what these people were doing and are doing. And that's... It's pretty heinous stuff, you know. It's just, but it's nothing new, and that's important to understand, because it's the same souls that are so utterly divisive and damaged for so long that they just can't do. They can't act any other way. Are they irredeemable? I don't know. I mean, but this is what we're seeing, and these are the same people, like we were talking about on the last show with the dome and the Tower of Babel. Same souls, different day. That's it. You know,
look, it's not lost on me either that the elections are held right after one of the high dark sacrificial periods, which is Samhain, or what we call Halloween here in the West. And right. There were obviously people putting information out that there were going to be ritual child sacrifices taking place in this period. And then 7 days later, you have the election. And these orgies that they have, these feeding frenzies, seem to be the fuel that powers their ability to continue to ride over mankind. This election wasn't just about the United States. And whether, you know, anyone participates like you and I, we're not in this system. We don't vote. We're not part of it. It impacts us. But there's a global, there's a planetary aspect to this in terms of the control grid, spiritually and psychologically, as a result of this harvesting that goes on. And I can't help but sense that the energetics behind it are what was feeding this outcome and this absolute hate frenzy that's now going on in the U.S. I mean, I've watched it on social media, both before and after the election. We're not done yet. We now have rioting in American cities as a result of the election of Donald Trump, which, you know, sort of indicates that the gods are still not placated. We're still kind of in this fire and brimstone period of turbulence. And so all of it just feels to me like one gigantic satanic brewfest.
Yeah, it's definitely hard to understand who who's vying for control, but... I do tend, like many people, in the physical realm here, understanding that these groups, that there are more than one group, possibly three, I guess, maybe, that are vying for control. And I always, you know, the way I put it to people when we're talking about these things is their center will never hold, because they're all like a pack of wild dogs, you know, running at full tilt in one general direction, veering off here and there a little bit. But they're generally running in one direction for the same ends using different means. But while they're running, they're close together, they're running, and they're biting and trying to tear at each other as they're running. And they're always vying for control or to preeminence, alpha, to become the alpha over the one who's out front at the moment. And that's why the center will never hold for them, because that's what they're all about. Where do they get that? Again, people have to remember that what they're seeing in the physical is nothing more than a reflection of the above, right? As above, so below. That's their mantra. So you're just seeing that whatever's happening in another slightly out of phase realm, which they are emulating, these sycophants, these human sycophants are emulating and working for, they're emulating the same thing. The same thing is going on there. So I think in the book, I think I use a portion of Job to show that you know, you have this Yahweh character, right, who might be upper management, appears, and then you have the sons of God appear, right? And then you also have the Satan character appear. All three coming from different directions to meet, and none of them seem to be in agreement with each other ever. And I think the nuances show as you go through their text that you'll see that they there's this pulling and everybody's wanting, you know, to be that alpha dog even amongst themselves. So you know, and they by various ways they do it. And what you're seeing with what we're all seeing with these insane people who are unfortunate. We call them insane. We call them a lot of words. They're children. I know you got Alex Jones, you know, making fun of them big time, saying that they're like little children. They're protesting a lawful democratic outcome, a result, which they are. It is ridiculous that they are. Because if it was reversed, of course, they wouldn't, you know, be standing in the street saying, well, you know, it was not fair to Trump that the electoral vote went this way or that way, you know. So they are acting like little children. But again, why? Why? Because, you know, like I said, like we've talked about from the beginning with this series, that they work through narratives. And the narratives, I think, are ultimately meant to be compiled and attached to the soul so that when the soul leaves the body, those narratives could then be utilized to drag the soul back into the system. Okay? So, equally, on Earth, what you're seeing here are people filled up to the brim with false narratives who believed all manner of lies and rejected all manner of truth. I mean, here you have these people when they're interviewed and whatnot saying, well, you know, Donald Trump was accused of, some women accused him of, you know. Okay, but all of those accusers walked away. You know, even other news have said that. The accusers have walked away. But their inability for critical thinking is epic. But there's a reason for it, because there's nothing left. They don't have any room left. It's all filled up with more than most of us with these false narratives, and they're completely unwilling to even consider them as false narratives. Therefore, they'll never eject any of the false narratives. Therefore, they'll never be able to put anything else in that bottle because it's completely full. And that's what the narratives are for. That what you're seeing is everything I wrote in the book. You're seeing it in real time, playing out in amazing ways, from the spirit cooking and child raping and everything else to these people, these souls who are so absolutely inundated with false information that regardless if the FBI and the New York police and everybody wants to arrest this woman because of the stuff that they found and they're putting out there that is the most heinous stuff to even be, even if you didn't do it, for to have these high officials come out and accuse you of it, that they have information that lends towards that you did it, that's beyond You know, I mean, even if someone is accused of that, you even if you don't believe that they probably did, you got to stand back. You got to stand back as a rational soul and say, hey, there's something going on here, because generally where there's smoke, there's fire. So it's not always true, especially when it's good people that the IRS or somebody else is, causing a fire in your front yard and you think they cause it. So, of course, we have that. You know, we have the other side. But now you have the establishment's establishment person. I mean, the ultimate establishment person. And it's hard for me, or it should be hard for anybody to believe that that these forces are making all this stuff up from God knows how long ago. And the unbelievable thing about it is, even in debates, she didn't even she didn't fight against it. I mean, you or I would have been we would have flipped out. Apoplectic. We would have just flipped out.
Well, most of this would be actionable in court. I mean, most of it would fall into the areas of slander and libel at an extreme level when you're talking about a high-profile public figure.
Exactly. So what we, in light of it all, you know, like we've talked about before, they're doing this through frequency control. They're doing this through soul control. And the fact, and the key to their whole soul control ability is the fact that we don't have memory. And because no one has memory of anything relevant in the past, could be millions of years in the past, we don't have any of that information. So all they have is to get filled up with these false narratives. And you're seeing it play out. I mean, I couldn't ask for a better display of everything I wrote in that book, Soul Revolution, than what just happened and what's ongoing. It's flabbergasting to see people that are so dumbed down and on top of it filled with false narratives and information that they don't even know that someone who lost an election can't go back and sue the United States government, like I heard someone trying to sound intelligent when they're being interviewed, saying that he thinks that she has to go back and sue the United States government to, what are we going to do? You know, we're going to keep having the election over and over again until Hillary wins. I mean, that blows my mind. That how did you even grow up in this country and not have any semblance of what, how this works? You know, it is shocking, and I know there's a lot going else in the background, subterfuge on both sides, and it's kind of hard. But that's what they're doing. They're, you know, through, like we talked about before, they're doing it through our souls. It all comes down to that, and it isn't because I wrote a book about it. It's because when you really crunch all the information, that's really what it comes down to. It's really hard to get away and pawn it off on it going for, in some other physical or human reason why these things are happening or why people act the way they're happening across the way they're acting across the board. And it's because of the way they've done it. They've used the frequency of our light, of, like we were talking about before, that, you know, like science has showed, all the cells and DNA of our bodies radiate light. And so it stands to reason, if you can limit that light, that cell, that DNA's, you know, the absorption of that light, then you can limit the soul's ability to interface in more pervasive ways. You know, that's pretty much like what I was talking about in the book. And and we know that all those codons are switched off. We know science has showed us that. We have most of our codons switched off. And like I said last time, it proves to me that, you know, that there's a reason why someone switched them off. They didn't switch them off for no reason. And they're not there for no reason. And you know, and I kind of go through all that in the book, and they limited all that. But why? Why did they limit all that stuff? They limit it because of control. And they control everything through the narratives. And that's what you're seeing playing out here, I think, in the most amazing way, you know. You know, do you agree with that? I mean, is that what you were seeing or thinking about in the bigger picture of what we're seeing here?
Yeah. Well, all of that. I guess what I'm trying to get to is the impact on the collective consciousness. And maybe you don't agree with me on this, but we're connected on a soul level to each other in some ways. Not to mention that we're also inside and outside of time connected to everything that occurred previously. So on the scale that we're talking about, these rituals, the pedophilia, the satanic ritual sacrifice, all of this is designed to keep looping us back into the soul harvesting machine and spitting us back out again into what looks to me like increasingly more horrific scenarios that are being conjured up inside of this matrix construct.
Yeah, exactly. And I do agree that souls are connected. My tendency is to believe that in our light body form, we were all connected to some degree, like a hive. Not so much that it's all controlled and it's all moves in the way of the majority, like birds do, or possibly bees. But
no, it's I view it as a consciousness, but not a will and intent. This is where people get stumbled.
Exactly.
Because even the concept that eventually we would resolve back to Creator, in a lot of people, creates this trip switch where they go, well, that means I cease to exist. In other words, the ceasing to exist of an individuated soul. And I don't think that in the scale of the creation itself, the intent was for us to be annihilated. That would effectively be soul annihilation. Because the consciousness defines the soul's beingness as individuated. If I understand, what you've put out, this is what I've gleaned from everything I've read and studied for decades, that would be annihilation on the soul level. So I look at this and I think we're just being looped back into this massive trauma loop that keeps us all connected to a system that perpetuates this violence.
Exactly, and just also, like I pointed out in the book, there's research showing that very good research showing that most all of us, or if not all of us, keep getting rotated back even into the same geographical areas and cultures, which is, I found, thoroughly amazing. And I give some points about that in the book of why that, why I think that would be done. But again, what does that do? That also, on a soul level, even creates a tribal effect. And the tribal effect is what is one of the narratives that they continue to use through time to keep all of us fighting, all of us against each other in one way or another on many, many levels. So even on that soul level, you'll see through this woman's research that they're even dropping us into the same areas over and over again, and with the same, what do they call, soul groups or people or souls. And that is, again, another narrative, because now you have, even within your alleged soul group, which probably grows a little bit after every life, through every life, then you have people that, through the other research I've seen done on near-death experiences, especially past life regression people, they have shown that people are coming back in different hierarchies. In other words, you're right now, last time, maybe this last time through, your son was your father, and these different things. And I know this also, you probably know this even better than me, that it goes back into other cultures that believe these things as well. And again, that's another, that would seem to me as another very useful tool, because not only are you creating, you're creating, by doing this, you're creating friction, undertones and friction from various levels, from the family level to the tribal level, because you're dropping the same souls in the same areas and the same cultures, and then from the tribal level to the global level, right? So you got to hand it to them. It's a pretty well thought out idea, a mechanism. It really is. So, when you start to see it, then it all starts falling in place. It's actually pretty easy to see, and then you'll see in the book, like I show, that's why I contend. That's why you have so much interfamily dysfunction.
Yes.
I mean, there's almost no family on earth that doesn't have pretty good levels of dysfunction. Most are extreme. So you got to look at that and say, why would that happen? Why, if a child that grows up in my house and learns my ways and knows his mother and his other siblings and everybody is, you know, we know our way, why would there be from 5-6 years old one person in that child or something that is so utterly at odds with one of the parents or even a sibling? In other words, when they have no background, the previous 4 or 5 years, 6 years has no background, has nothing back there that would give anybody the suggestion of here's why this kid just absolutely viscerally hates his brother or his sister and is always contending, I'm the boss.
I lived this. This is part of my background. I mean, I had this within my own family. And I'll tell you, in our situation, my father passed away about 5 years ago. And at the time of his death, I had the opportunity to break something. And that was Masonic ties that were deep within specifically the paternal side of my family, going back through at least 3 generations I was aware of, and included my father, my uncles, my grandfather, and then my mother, by virtue of the fact that when she married my father, went into the Masonic order known as the Eastern Star. So when it came time to do my father's funeral arrangements, because they were mainstream Christians, the pastor of the church literally came to me. This is a woman minister in a Methodist church, and said, did you want the Freemasons to come in for the ceremony? And I looked at her and I said, no. And she seemed rather surprised. She said, well, your father was a lifelong Mason. I said, key word here is was. I said, I've broken those vows over him. I said, they will not be here. I don't want them here. I said, my father has disavowed that, and I've done it in his name. And there, I noticed that even within myself, there was a healing that occurred here. Because I was approached by the Masons 3 times, which is, I'm told, the number of times that you will be approached before they no longer come to your door. And I have a reason to believe that that was a curse. And I have a reason to believe that by breaking it as the eldest son, I possibly cleared my father as he passed over. Now, all of that's speculative, but it's based on my belief structure, even from the time that I was going through the church, from the time that I was a minister, from the time that I worked in spiritual warfare and the prophetic side of the church. My understanding was simply going back to the curses upon the generations 3 and 4 generations deep.
Mm-hmm.
So, in some ways, that I had a sibling who was basically a rival. I mean, it was a classic Abel Cain situation, younger brother warring against older brother. And I don't know what spirit that is. I mean, it caused horrible splits in my family even to this day. But I would like to think that at least by cutting off those influences, somehow it cleared the soul's path back, because those attachments were no longer permissibly allowed to operate in the family lines, which clearly, in my understanding, were what you indicated as well. These generations coming back in and cycling through into familial soul groups.
Exactly. That really, I'm all ears if someone else can give me a physical manifestation of why this happens in most all families. It has to be the higher percentage of families. And, I've seen it so many times, as you have, and others, now that we've said it, will say, hey, you know, yeah, I recognize that even in my own family. And that's what I think it is. They're doing that, and they're doing it, and they're able to do it because of the memory wipe, which is really the main key to all of this.
Right, right.
Is that memory wipe, because it's a chief tactic among, you know, that they've utilized in their that mechanism of soul, you know, memory elimination. It's, you know, their will is totally divergent. It's opposite. It's an opposite refraction to the prime creator's will of abundant life, mercy, etc. When you look at it from that direction, there, that's what they're doing, and so they have different levels. It takes a long time to really peer into this, and keep adjusting your binoculars and keep writing down on your on your paper there, you know, drawing your picture of what you're seeing. And it takes a long time to put this all in perspective and to understand that there's different levels, and it expands out right to left, top to bottom. It's a fairly simple system, it seems. It's just very creative. It's the way they did it. It's maybe not creative, but it's
nefarious. It's diabolical. And that's
diabolical.
The whole point. When I initially began reading Soul Revolution, coming off of, you know, some interviews that you had done with our friend George Ann Hughes and the earlier work, The Land of Meat and Honey, this book was such a thrust forward. But what was really occurring was you were basically bringing out the same points that I was grappling with as well, which was the memory wipe. Which is because it's like, you know, we've read all the near-death experiences, the people that have documented these things and looked at this whole phenomena and realized that something was going on with this. And I got to preface this, because most Christians have been trained to not believe in reincarnation. You know, that there's almost nothing in the extant scriptures, the 66 books compiled as called the Holy Bible, that eliminates reincarnation. And in fact, Yeshua refers to John the Harbinger, John the Baptist, as being in the spirit of Elijah. And he also says, before Abraham was, I am. So he identifies even himself in a pre-existent state in some form. And yet Christians...
Well, If he said that before Abraham there was, or how it would have been said in the Hebrew, before Abraham existed, I am, then he wasn't speaking about himself. He wasn't. There's
okay.
No way. If that's what he said, I don't remember hearing that ever, but before Abraham existed, then in English it would have to be interpreted literally, mechanically, as before Abraham existed, Ahaya, which is the true name of the Creator, which was given to Moshe on Mount Horeb, having nothing to do with Mount Sinai. So that in and of itself is pretty interesting. But I do believe what you're saying. Like, I do remember saying, hearing something about Elijah, you know, John the Baptist is Elijah. I know a lot of people believe that. And that very well could be, because who would you send back? You'd send back, you know, you'd send back your special forces. You're going to drop in your Delta teams. And who's that be? You know, who's Yeshua? Yeshua is probably, as I've said in many of the books, especially my, I go into this in greater detail in my Asher Codex, Yeshua is probably the elect one that is spoken about many times in other places, especially in Enoch. So, it's probably him. I could go there. That's fine. And he's got a very important purpose, and probably been here several times doing that, you know, and whatnot. And again, and that's important. But I'm sorry, I didn't mean to cut you off there. But
no, that's okay. The clarification's good. This is a dynamic, fluid conversation. My point was largely that even the people who are professing Christians have denied that there is a reincarnational cycle. And as a result of that, they're not really getting the big picture of this at all, because they don't understand what, first off, they don't even understand what the sin was. They're focused on all kinds of other things. They don't understand the scope of this thing in terms of the violence to the living beings on the planet, which is, you know, the core of all of this. I mean, we're talking about human sacrifice and pedophilia, satanic ritual abuse, but we never talk about the violence that's been done to our fellow creatures on the planet as a result of even our dietary habits, which, you know, I will just say this to people who are hearing this, wherever you are on the continuum, if you are being led away from the consumption of meat, allow that process to go through. I understand that the planet is one gigantic slaughterhouse, and it is very difficult. And this is something I didn't plan to talk to you about, but I'll drop this in since I'm on this tangent. It is very difficult for people who are not practicing as vegan vegetarians, people who are not eating meat, to wean themselves out of the system because of the culture itself. I mean, every corner, you've got a McDonald's, a Wendy's, a Hardee's, some hamburger joint. You go into restaurants. I have to travel occasionally where I have limited choices of diet. We live in a world that is a giant abattoir. It is Meat City. And this is a very difficult thing to wean yourself from. What I'm saying is, you know, it is a process. It is not something you get up one day and decide to do if you're in this system.
No, there has been over the years a few people out of thousands and thousands that have learned from me that have changed because of the first book, which had evidently had a very unexpected and powerful how it acted on people's souls. It just opened them up, opened them up. But they knew. They already knew it.
Yeah.
It just allowed them to take that last step. But I have had people, just one recently, one of your listeners actually, had written me, and she said that she had been led on her own, years ago, to do that. So there have been some that are, but most aren't. And yeah, it is definitely the culture, and that culture is slowly, but it's picking up. The change is picking up.
Which brings us, we can drop this in here now. That I see, there's always a reason why I go off on one of my wild tangents. This article that comes from The Guardian that you sent me, Italy's first vegetarian city, Turin, residents divided meat free, and the article is about what's going on in the city of Turin, where it appears as though the tide there is turning towards vegan vegetarian diets.
Which is, almost an insane thing to be even considering to do in Italy of all places.
Yeah, really.
Mm-hmm. Because you know, everything, you know, like I always say, take the meat away from any chef and you're going to find out that your wife is 100 times better cooked than any chef on the planet, except for possibly guys like, what's his name on the Hell's Kitchen, you know. So, yeah, you got, who, by the way, I believe went vegetarian several years ago. And there's, it is definitely the culture, and it is amazing that they're picking that up in touring Italy, that they want to go and move in that direction. I think I might have said it on one of the last shows that I heard one of the women, high up in the World Health Organization, it was, you might be able to find it on YouTube, she was giving a speech, I think I saw it on someone's documentary, and she was giving a speech saying that the world has to very quickly stop the breeding of all farm animals for consumption and stop eating animals completely because it is damaging, you know, they believe it's damaging, the methane gas is building up under the dome. So I saw that too as well, and I knew I saw this 5-6 years ago, that things were starting to trend in this direction. Maybe a little longer than that I saw that, but I hadn't convinced myself yet until after that first book, The Land of Meat and Honey, and then I knew that something was going to happen. So this new news from Turin, Italy, I think is pretty amazing that they would, you know, the governor or whatever, the mayor and his staff would even consider saying that out loud in Italy at all is amazing to me. But you know, it'll at least bring awareness, and those who will hear, and those that won't. And but it's still got worldwide circulation. And but like you say, but it's not only culture. It's like I do show and prove in the first book through texts and through just logic that, and through science, that the consumption of the meat lowers your frequency. Again, you got to remember, all this has to do with frequency at its base level, right? When the Creator created light in the beginning, like I go into the book very in-depthly, that light wasn't the light you see as the sun and all that. He created light. But how did he do it? They said, well, you know, he spoke it into existence, right? You know, okay, that's the third grade version. But the adult version is that he utilized frequency to create things. And therefore, frequency is also used to uncreate things or to damage things as well. Because if it can go one way, it can go the other. And so when I think I put it in the Soul Revolution as well. I did. I touched on it. I didn't want to go into it in too much depth because Land of Meat and Honey hits on it pretty hard. But I did make sure I put it in Soul Revolution, the science and behind that animals have a much lower frequency. They output a much lower frequency, 20 to 25 hertz, versus the optimal human frequency being, I believe it's around 80 hertz or 82, I believe, something like that. So when we introduce that lower frequency flesh consumption, okay, then you're lowering your frequency dramatically, which then the science tells us that humans' frequency, for a myriad of reasons, under, what is it, 72 or 75 hertz, something like that, that's when you start seeing your chronic illnesses begin. And down when you drag your...
Okay, so we had a power outage here, so we lost power. We're back on. Shmuel, go ahead and kind of just pick up where you left off.
Well, I guess quickly just to, I believe I was heading towards saying that the the consumption that and I had put in a book, lastly, that the science shows that the human body actually utilizes more energy, more life force, to digest the intake of any meat and mammal products that you're eating than you gain from the products as they are. So there's that. And so really what we're seeing, like you were saying, it's cultural, but and it is cultural, but the cultural part of it, as I show, and we've said here 100 times, I guess, already, that the cultural part of it is yet part of the main narrative push to keep it in front of you, to keep you doing that original sin, if you want to call it that, like the Christians call it that. Like you were saying, they don't even understand what that sin was, yet they do it every single day. And that's the idea. The narratives are there to continue to enhance their ability to push that on us through that memory wipe. So it's not only the food. It's not only cultural. It's also the fact that when you are consuming this stuff, right, that you are lowering that frequency, your soul's ability to even get through, to even allow you to, on the conscious level, to understand that that's what the problem is. So the meat consumption, the death and animal consumption in and of itself is probably the strongest narrative and the most important part for these rebellious, rulers, that it's their key function. It's the main thing that they have to keep going in under all circumstances and at all costs, because that's the main thing that firewalls you from returning, from even becoming cognizant of the fact that that you should return. So they use all the other religious narratives and other religious history narratives and supernatural narratives, junk science, nationalism, aliens, you name it. That's just all on top of all the other narratives.
Exactly.
Are just on top of that. So that's a real important thing for people to understand, that consumption is actually aiding and feeding or fueling the main firewall to the soul. And in many ways, physically and spiritually, and it's funny, I'll just go into this for a second, but recently someone brought up the question of what I thought about when Jesus was telling people, Yeshua was telling people to that they should stop eating. Fasting
right.
Is what word they use. So that they should fast and then pray. And so they were asking, what do you think about fasting? Because I don't necessarily see that in the Hebrew culture. Long before that time that he was teaching that, which it kind of really isn't in as a tool, like as in the way that I see people using it or talking about today, that the church is saying, we all have to fast for 10 days because we want this to happen, and when we fast there's more power. It's not that there's more power when they fast, and this is my answer, and it's conducive to what we're talking about here, that it's not that there's more power, it's that it's the first time you're even being heard. So what he's doing, Yeshua, is to people that he couldn't possibly have this conversation with, couldn't possibly explain quantum physics to, or anything on these levels. He is just giving them the nuts and bolts. He's saying, instead of, I firmly believe that he from what I've seen, and that he was teaching the everlasting agreement. He was living it, and he was teaching it.
Yeah.
And he was also utilizing the true name of the Creator, which was, by the way, today and then, as I show in the first book, especially back then, was against the law, and it was an immediate sentence of death through the Pharisees. excuse me. So it was a big thing for him to be doing that. A very big thing. And I contend that that's why.
The reference point for what you're talking about there in terms of the New Testament was the disciples came back to him and they weren't able to cast out a demon. Now this gets interesting. And he looked at them and he was exasperated, and I'm paraphrasing wildly. He said, these kind only come out with prayer and fasting. Now that's key. Because the fasting he was talking about was giving up the traditional meat-based diet and
right.
clearing the frequency fields.
Without saying it.
Without saying it,
right?
We don't know, because so much, you know, the problem is that you only have, you have very little context in all of these books to construe certain facts from, and you have bad translations, bad transmissions, additions, deletions, all of that. So you're left with, you know, what I have whittled down to the skeletal texts of all of this over the years, which throws out just about everything except the core
right.
sayings of Yeshua for guidance. You really have to just go back and go through all of this stuff with a lot of discernment. But I mean, you have the Christian church, they tell you to fast, but I watch a local Pentecostal church here on Sunday mornings after church. They have a steakhouse adjacent to their property. The place is flooded with Christians going in there after church.
Right.
They host pot roast dinners. The celebration of the Passover, as it was transmitted, was killing a lamb and roasting it with bitter herbs, the blood on the lentil, all of that. I mean, we have a bloody culture in Judeo-Christianity.
Right. Which, by the way, in the first book, Lamb Mean Honey, I prove that all false. I show you the
yes.
actual text.
Yes.
But, yeah, you're exactly right. And that's what I was telling this person when they asked me about this. I said, look, you know, you gotta put yourself in that time. Who is he talking to? Now, at those times, it seems to me he was in crowds or he was talking to other people outside of his Talmudim, which is his taught ones,
mm-hmm.
his apostles, if you want, whatever you call them. So he's not going to sit down and do like I learned not to do this so many years ago, because their eyes glaze over. They don't have the capacity to sit there and listen to someone like me tell them exactly what it is. So he's basically just saying, look, just do this. First fast, then pray. Not pray and fast. It's first fast, then pray.
Clear.
Because, believe me, brother, you are not being heard.
Clear the fields.
Before.
Not only that, but you're not going to hear either. This is
you're not going to hear either, right, exactly.
And I can tell you this, because I've done the fasting, and I've done all of that, and you don't get breakthrough spiritually until after you clear all of this. It's about
exactly.
72 hours to do the initial purge, but it's actually more like 14 days to get a clear cycle. So a good fast is going to be probably between 14 and 21 days. Going through
right.
the cycles.
And what's funny from what you're saying there is, again, in my first book, I show through another apocryphal text that for many years I didn't even look at because I wouldn't take seriously at all. But once I did, I was like, you know, oh, wow, I can't even believe I ignored this. But strangely enough, and I show in the first book, Land of Meat and Honey, that it has this strange saying in there that I've never heard in anything remotely Hebrew culturally. but basically to me, it felt like it should have been. It felt like it was. So it says, he says, allegedly he says, and it's apocryphal, a scene text, that he's telling them to stop eating, stop killing, stop eating, you know, stop doing this, stop doing that, you know, stop killing the animals, stop eating them. And because when you eat their tongue, this happens to your tongue. When you eat their eyes, this happens to your eyes. If you eat their blood, this happens to your blood. And he goes through this list, which sounds like Dr. Oz. And like a Dr. Oz show. It is an amazing list. And what I found amazing was when you eat their something or other, you know, when you eat their eyes, which people do, it creates cataracts on your eyes. And when you, and it just went through this list, and I thought, wow, you know, scientifically, medically speaking, everything in this list is spot on. Spot on. So at the end of the list, it says, and if you stop doing this, it says, for every 7 years that you have done.
Yes, I remember this. This is great.
Yes. You will be cleansed in 7 days. So now if, you know, whatever your age is, you know, you can multiply that and you can see what, you know, go backwards and see how many weeks it will take you to receive that cleansing, to, you know, and I just found that to be the most amazing thing. I've never heard of that before, and I thought, wow, you know, that's a hell of a thing for just somebody to make up off the cuff. Anybody, whether it was his words or somebody else's words, it's kind of an odd thing, even by today's standards, to just make up, because it's very obscure, I think, way of thinking about it. And But that's what it says. So now we look at the way people fast. You say 14 days or 21 days. Well, there you go. Most people under the age of 50 are going to be in that time frame of days, of weeks, before they're mostly cleansed or fully cleansed. So of that, and able to now be at least open that spiritual connection again. Now, I contend that, yes, you might gain that cleansing in that time, as he said, 7 days for every 7 weeks, or sorry, 7 days for every 7 years that you have partaken in this sin, but I contend that it takes a little longer. It will might be the bulk of the cleansing, but, you know, a year, 2 years after, that's when you really start noticing a difference in everything about you. And I mean, you know, I'm not talking about just somebody who's decided. Now, I'm sure it works mechanically. I'm sure it is somewhat mechanical that once someone just decides, you know what, I just think this is a bad idea, I don't believe in killing animals, so I'm just going to stop eating animals and I'm going to be a vegan, and they do it for the health of the animals, and there is nothing spiritual, there's nothing. Although you might contend that is spiritual right off the bat, and I say yes, you're right, it is. But, you know, they're not religious. They haven't read my book or anybody else's, and they're not really doing it for God. They're not doing it, you know, for a creator or anything like that. They're just doing it because they feel inside themselves something was awoken and it decided. So I contend that 7 days for every 7 years is mechanical. But what takes you the rest of the way is the spiritual, is the understanding, as I laid it out in that Land of Meat and Honey book, that you are so, and this new book, that you are so much, you are far greater than them and than what you think. Therefore, when you understand it in that context and you live your life and you think about that constantly and you live your life projecting that constantly, that's why you saw that email that I sent out. I think you referred to it earlier, that I sent out to thousands of people after I heard about the spirit cooking stuff. See, did you get that email that I told I
yes,
was asking
yes,
all the
I
people?
Got that, yeah.
Right, and I put that out because there's many, many thousands of people that are connected to me through email and otherwise, and I sent it out to just instructing everybody that, you know, if I'm correct, and believe me, it would take a whole lot of some other information from somewhere else that no one has found yet to make me incorrect. So if I'm correct about this, and all of you within the everlasting agreement who have been living it, who truly believe it and been living it, have a direct line to the Creator, supersonic, quantum, direct, correlated link back to the Creator that didn't exist before you did this, that most other people do not have, then you are the most important people on the planet for this. That you did not do this. I was trying to explain to people, and like I've done many times, they say, "Oh, that's great. You know, I've done this for myself, and it's good. I feel better. I feel more spiritual. I feel closer to God." But I. Okay, that's great, but that's not what it's for. It's that's the first step. The second step is that we're all correlated because we all believe this, and we're all connected again. Therefore, when you go out and get on your knees and pray, again, I did another thing on prayer not too, in the same email 2 weeks ago when the person asked me about why Yeshua was telling them to fast, that also prayer is frequency. But it doesn't work if you're at a frequency, if you're out of that link. So that's what I was telling everybody, that you're probably the most important people on the planet. As far as this goes, your frequency, your link, your tether to the Creator has been cleaned, all right? That aerial has been, you know, all the rust has been taken off of it, and it's been reconnected and, you know, and pulled tight now. So it's ready to go. And you need to get the hell out there, and you need to use that frequency we call prayer and just literally drive it down these evil scum's throat. Drive it down their throat, because that power, one of us, is more power than any 10,000 of them. So that's why I sent that email, so that people would hear that and say, yeah, you know what, this is really sick stuff that they're doing to children, and so I cannot take that. And that's why I was telling in that email for people, now listen to what I'm saying, go look at what they're doing, go do a little research, and let this become an emotionally driven level in you. Become disgusted, feel like you want to vomit when you listen to what came out in those WikiLeaks and what they're doing to children and what they think they're doing to gain their power and stuff like that. Make it an emotional cue so that when you send those prayers, when you drive that out, it's strong. Because, you know, not like I said in that email, not only does the Creator hear the innocent blood crying from the ground, but He also hears you. Because you're connected once again. You've returned. And that's why I sent that email out. And that's, so prayer and fasting, is, you know, when we talk about that in the frequencies and all, it's all about the frequency. It's all about the soul's connection to the Creator and allowing, we either allow Him to intercede or we stop Him from interceding. And so you have all these people, like you say, come out of church, you know, and they give each other a finger in the parking lot trying to get out faster than the next guy.
Yeah. I've seen that,
you know,
too.
And then to get across the steak and shake, and they're beyond clueless. Nothing was heard in that building. Nothing was heard after that building. If they're on their knees next to their bed at home, nothing's being heard. And I tend to believe that that's Yeshua's job as the elect one. Possibly that's one of His jobs. What you know, that's in His job description, is possibly under certain conditions with certain people that are not living the everlasting year, that have not returned, that their information, their frequency, although it's dirty, it's a dirty frequency, and it's hardly hearable, you know, but that I think that's His part of His job, is to get the elect's, because that's what it says in Enoch, that the elect one's job is to oversee the elect. And the elect are those, and it says very clearly, those who are not righteous because they do not follow the instructions, the expectations of the Creator, of God. That's what it says. That it, and it also says, in contrast, right before that, that there are the righteous who do follow the instructions of the Creator. See? So there's two. So the elect one is over the elect. When what I find funny is that Christians tend to call themselves the elect, right? Without even knowing what they're probably referring to. So I think that might be his job to maybe pull some of those prayers out and get them, you know, boost them, kind of like a signal booster to some degree. But this is all about frequency, and it's all about the condition of the physical and your soul, the spiritual. You know, because as I touched on earlier, you know, this has all got to do, you can't do this without a memory wipe. So like we previously touched on several times, the archons and their have their continued ability, you know, for that memory wipe mechanism, to use that memory wipe mechanism.
Well, it's,
that appears.
It's funny that you brought up earlier about eyes. You know, if you eat the eyes of the animals, you get cataracts and all of this. And I want to pull something back here. We were talking earlier about our body's light emissions. And I'll put this in the show notes with this show when it goes out. People can look up, for basic research on this, the work of Dr. Fritz Albert Popp and biophoton research. That'll give you a good scientific grasp on that particular area. And then, again, you know, what Yeshua was talking about and what some of these people are asking about, when he says, if the light of the body is the eye, if therefore thine eye be single, thy whole body shall be full of light, which is, for you Christians out there, in Matthew 6:22. It says, and if thy eye be evil, the whole body will be full of darkness. He's laying down some fundamentals here that actually go into what we're talking about. With the idea that there's a correlation, even energetically, in terms of our physiology. I mean, and I do think this is a physiology lesson. I think he was kind of being literal here. Some people said this is the third eye thing. I don't agree with that. I've looked at the translations. I'm not down with that. I think this is a more fundamental lesson here in what you would see if you look carefully at Fritz Albert Popp's research on biophotonic research.
Yeah, no doubt. I doubt highly him being Hebrew. In our culture, you're not going to be banging around talking about the third eye and getting all metaphysical with most people that you're talking about, because or talking to, because they just don't have the capacity to understand that. And I do realize that everybody over time is super spiritualized and misunderstood, well, because of, like you said, all the redactions, deletions, changes, and everything that have been done to that New Testament. I mean, I know a woman that wrote a book on that, on all the stuff that was done to it, and very much like my work, but in the New Testament, it was really outstanding. I think I have it. I think I show it. I think I show her stuff for sale on my blog. But they, and if they're not there anymore, I better put them back up. But it's true that they don't realize, they don't get the depth of much of what he was saying. Not that he was getting very in depth. It seems to me like he's not a lot different than I am. The same personality. You're just gonna, yeah, give it to you straight. I'm not gonna sugarcoat it. I'm not gonna get too. I'm not gonna, you know, get all professor on you. You know, I'm just gonna give it to you straight, simple, as fast as I can, because I need to move on.
The point of this is really to encourage people that are already on the path. I'm not interested in preaching much of anything to people out there. I mean, I did that for 7 years on radio, and what I got for my trouble was a lot of grief, and in the end wound up challenging my own belief system. So, but I will say that it encourages people to press forward, because it's not an easy thing to do. I mean, if you're raised in a culture that embraces veganism, vegetarianism, and not violating that basic tenet, I don't have a reference for that. I grew up around on my mother's side of the family, my grandparents were cattle ranchers. And so I grew up in a culture of basically, you know, slaughterhouse mentality. And it's very difficult when you're in that to even get it out of you psychologically, much less systemically. And one of the things that has really convicted me over the years has been we're not only taking in biological materials that are contaminants to our own biological system, but now we're taking in all of the antibiotics and all of the things that they're now using to do factory farming. So now we're adulterating at a chemical level, which on top of the chemtrails, the GMOs, and all the other things, is really cutting us off fast from our fundamental biology.
Yeah, because I think we spoke about this earlier and mentioned it, you know, that I will not contend with man for more than 120 years from now on, which was allegedly said by the creator, which was not the creator. That's very important to understand because, taking on that same level, the longer you live, the more time you have to come to these conclusions for your soul to start pushing through and coming to these conclusions and then therefore being awake. And what that does then is reverse all the damage of the narratives that was done in that lifetime, which then possibly in that lifetime, depending on how far you go with this new enlightenment, say you're 90 years old, 100 years old, allowed to live to 120, even in decent condition where you can think and extrapolate. And, you know,
yeah, good luck with that, too, by the way. There's people now in their 60s and 70s that are early onset dementia as a result of the prions that are in cattle. I mean, we're basically a culture that's trending now towards autism. I mean, cultural autism.
Right, and it's done on purpose because that enlightenment. If you need a certain amount of Duracell batteries on Earth,
exactly.
Right?
Yes.
Then you might need a certain amount, but you also don't need them to really live past this point now because the enlightenment is happening faster and faster because it's a wave, so it's happening faster and faster, sooner and sooner and sooner, not faster, sooner. So therefore, I'm not going to contend with man for 60 years. That'll be the next fake, you know, book that somebody finds after this epoch is over. So, you know. And there you go. So that's how I look at that, and I see that, and that's what they're doing. That's why you have this absolute onslaught of this. But again, what does that do? That makes living that everlasting agreement, and if you want to call it a diet, then fine. That's not what it is. But once you get into that and start living that, and the more people that do it, that greatly annuls what they're doing to a large extent. And they see it going that way, which is why the chemtrails, which is why, you know, look at the new two flu. There's two new flu vaccines coming out this year, one for children, one for elderly people. And I just watched some doctor on a show saying, going through the adjuvants that are in it, and he flat out said, I have never in my life seen a more destructive cocktail than this. In fact, one of the adjuvants in it was the one that has been proven to cause all the damage in the Gulf War vets, and they added another 10 plus adjuvants to the new two new flu vaccines this year. So that are just coming out, and he backtracked and saw, well, all right, let me look at the company that made these, and they also happen to be a military-backed bio company as well, you know, for biological weapon research. So, yeah, that's why they're hitting us from so many different areas like that, because they're seeing that wave come sooner and sooner, and people are changing, and they can't. And also, you have to remember, is something that most people probably don't think of, but it's kind of like, you know, the top of a pyramid. You know, it's much smaller area. You don't need as many people as you think, as many souls as you think, to break over that. I don't even believe you need 51%.
No, nowhere near that. No, single digits.
Nowhere near that. Right. So you need a small percentage, which, again, is that in context, like I do, I think, in the Soul Revolution book, the new book, I get into, as others get into, other scientists, Dr. Puglio gets into his idea of what the 144,000 souls are, blah, 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 that Christianity is thoroughly distorted an understanding of. And I go into my rendition of what I believe it is, and in this context, and when you look at it that way, it makes a lot more sense that it would, you might only need, that many, and now it's saying, it says that many from each tribe, so times 12, so it's not that many people compared to 6 billion that are on the planet, even if you multiply it by 12. So
it's what I've called for a couple of years now, the pivot effect. Basically, everything turns on a very tiny point in the continuum, and you call it a pivot. And the people that are moving things are the pivot. My numbers are somewhere between 3 and 5%, and I don't even think it has to be as high as 5 on the face of this earth right now. And I think we're at critical mass based on what you've talked about, I've talked about. I think what we're both seeing in terms of the soul revolution really starting to kick in. And I actually think we may have seen some of that in this election, although not in the way people think. I'm not touting Donald Trump here as the answer to things. What I think happened was a reaction to a blowback, which is why you had these WikiLeaks leaks coming out. I don't know. I mean, personally, I'm of the opinion that WikiLeaks and Assange are somewhat controlled by intelligence operations as well. Otherwise, they would all be dead and the servers would have been taken out. I've seen the FBI is capable of locating servers, isolating them, and taking them down even via remote control. So there's some utility aspect that's connected to the cabal with this. But I do think that they're now working on very short timelines in terms of deploying plans, because they have to respond now to things that were not on their radar in the last couple of elections. And that is the fact that people are waking up. So it's not about Trump, but it is about the reaction that came as a result of these revelations that came out about the Clintons specifically and about the elites in general.
No doubt. I mean, they're a very large percentage, and they're totally lying about her winning the populist vote. That is a complete lie, and I know it's a lie, and I knew it was a lie. I knew something was wrong, but then 3, 4, 5 days later, whatever, she hasn't come out and asked for a recount or anything like that. And the reason why is because no way is she going to do that. Because if they start digging into that, and I think they'll find that the landslide was far worse.
I do too. That's what I think. It was. It was profound. So profound they couldn't suppress it.
Right, and the reason for that, I think a lot of it is like we're talking about here, is at the soul level, the people are starting to see and understand that there's a captivity, there's an oppression here that they didn't think was oppression 10 years ago, 5 years ago even. But now the soul's actually feeling that pressure. And then all it took was that information. Like you say, yeah, you think Assange would be alive if he wasn't backed by somebody. And also, what's his name in Russia? The other guy that worked for the NSA.
I just had a brain,
Him too. I mean, come on. They're both, and Assange helped him, by the way, get out of China, I believe. So,
Well,
of course.
I think what people need to remember.
Go ahead.
what people need to remember is what we were talking about earlier in the book, and we weren't real specific about it, but it had to do with the fact that basically the rebellion that occurred was split itself. I mean, you know, what happened on Mount Harmon, that's all being amplified on the, you now have a planet that's run by effectively factions, or as I like to call them, criminal syndicates, and they're competing.
Yeah, dogs next to each other, but they're biting each other along the way.
Exactly, yeah, exactly
what I was saying.
So there isn't some grand unified evil plot. There are numerous plots. There are numerous factions that are working to bring these things out at any given time. And the circles are getting tighter and tighter now. I mean, Trump's by far not clean. I've connected him to the P2 Lodge in Italy. I've connected him to the Mafia, the Masonic Lodges. He has his own baggage, because you're not going to get a clean person elected to a public office. It's just that simple. So all this is just a window that opens up right now that allows some other things to happen in the background, even as they're reconfiguring and masterminding and attempting to do damage control.
Yeah, it's just another way to get to roughly the same end result. and like an article someone sent me that went into his background, depth of his family, and Wharton College and the originator of Wharton College, and how they've had dealings all the way back in Templar times, back to Ireland. Scotland. And then you see Trump doing a lot of building and a lot of stuff in Scotland, of all places.
Yeah.
So, yeah. You know, there's that connection. So yeah, it very well could be, like I said, different factions vying for the same, roughly the same end, but they have different means. Like the one, the Hillbilly faction, as I call it, they want to depopulate. They want to just completely overcome, destroy. They're Nazis. They're flat out Nazis. Whereas you have possibly his faction wants prosperity. He doesn't want to destroy everyone. He doesn't want to kill everyone, put everyone in camps, things like that. He wants law and order. He's a little bit scary on that. when I hear certain things, but I guess you'll have to see how that plays out. But it's, you know, there's that. And oh my!
Sorry, I had a file.
Can you still hear me?
Yep.
Yes. I told a friend of mine, and we were talking about this, and I said, you know, when you look, if that information was true about Trump and his people, that they're quote unquote Templars, which people will say, well, that's just a club. That's just like the Masons. Or well, if you, my friend that I was talking to happens to be, you know what he's talking about with the Templars. He's done a lot of research into them, and he's talked to me about them, a lot over the years. And from what I've understood, they made a lot of money from the King of France through the King of France and the King of England at the time, and they got paid in lands, and they had a huge amount of gold and whatever else they took from Jerusalem. And because of their power and everything, that they became very rich, and they built places, they fixed places, they helped people, they guarded people. It seems to me that was their MO. It didn't seem to me like from what I've ever heard or read about them, and I might be wrong in the way I'm taking it, but from what he's told me, another book on a very, very well-written book he gave me on the Templars years ago that I read, it kind of sounded to me like they weren't like the kings and queens of France and England, a very destructive, very, you know, it's all about control, it's all about destruction, it's all about taxing, it's all about owning, you know, where they were a little bit different, although they owned a lot and had a lot of money, they became very powerful, and it scared, obviously, the two monarchs, but which had most of them killed, and they went underground and evidently reemerged and possibly still have all that gold. Who knows? But, I mean, you know, I even look at the things we're seeing here, extrapolating, like, what he's saying. Like, look at what he's saying. You know, we're going to do this, we're going to do that, we're going to have this infrastructure, that infrastructure, we're going to fix this, we're going to fix that, we're going to build that, we're going to build this, we're going to, you know, all these new jobs are going to bring people back. Dude, you're standing in front of an empty vault. And you're telling me this? You're literally standing in front of an empty vault. I can look right past you and see the vault empty, but you're telling me all this, that you're going to do this, you're going to build this, you're going to restructure it. I mean, it sounds insane. I mean, I have to agree with the left-wingers for that. Everything he's been saying, it's like, yo, how are you going to do that without a massive influx of new coin from somewhere? So I'm starting to wonder if there isn't a massive influx of new coins somewhere.
I can tell you, it's funny you bring that up. Actually, there is. And there's actually a very interesting succession of processes that began on election eve once Mr. Trump was confirmed. Because like I said before, I don't view Trump himself either way. There's a window here that's occurring, and there's strategic moves that are being made, not just based on one event, but based on multiple things that are occurring globally and inside of the United States. And so right now, because of the fact that this is going to be, the chain of power is disrupted. As of that night, everything changed. There are opportunities that are presenting. So anybody who is able to look at currency markets right now should be able to discern some changes that are going on in the currency markets, looking at the Forex. And if you're a real student of this, you'll note some things. And I'll just say that it looks to me like the return to hard currency on one level is almost fait accompli, because we cannot continue this derivative debt-based banking system. And we also need to go off of the petro oil dollar, because that's tanking as well. Look at gas right now. Gas prices went up for a few weeks. They dropped back down again. They can't get their oil prices up anymore. So there's a lot in flux right now for people who are students of this to look around and actually be encouraged by, I think.
Yeah, because it seems like they're... That's why I was bringing up the history of the Templars, because when I look at them, and I read that history, and I look at him, you know, and I thought, wow, it's a lot alike. You know, he's a builder. He builds stuff. He creates jobs. He creates infrastructure. He's creating. He's making things happen. And you and I grew up with Donald Trump. We, you know, me in New York most of my life.
Yeah, of course.
You grow up with the guy. You've heard everything about him. He's always in the news, helping somebody, doing something for somebody. So all that stuff is true, you know, about him. And I never personally, I don't remember ever hearing any scandalous stuff about him. I mean, the biggest thing I think they brought up in this particular election, Hillary was saying, well, you know, he went bankruptcy and he used the bankruptcy laws. Well, yeah, him and every other person that's ever been in business, you know, has used the laws that, like he said, you made. Your husband made the laws, so of course I used them, you know. So if you don't want me to use them, take them off the books. What can I tell you? You know, so we understand that as straight talk, whereas a lot of the other people in midsection of the country might look at that, well, you know, he's probably doing something illegal or so. You know, look, you don't get to that point, you know, where you're skating the edge of illegalities when you're dealing with money. But I never heard that he was eating children. I never heard that he was drinking blood. I never heard that he was at Bohemian Grove. I never heard any of this insanity that you're hearing from the other side, which it's so insane, most people don't even believe it. You know, they have a very hard time believing that stuff is really out there or possible. And, you know, but if you really start looking into it, you'll find out that Anonymous a few years ago gave a whole list of people from the English monarchy down to shopkeepers in England and people that ran schools, charter schools in England and stuff, all being in cahoots with abducting and utilizing children for black rituals and one even to the point of one who was a large shoe manufacturer, shoe maker, taking the skin of those children and making the shoes that they make the children wear, the slippers that they make the children wear of other children's skin during these rituals. So this stuff is so off the hook for most people that they don't even want to think about it, you know, because it's really not in most people to be okay with that level of darkness, you know. And that's good, because that's what I say in also in the book, that, you know, most souls are really only supposed to be or able to project light and love, and, you know, but it's all the narratives and all the other stuff that we consume from the physical level that enables that, you know. So yeah, that, you know, when we're looking at this, I've been wondering what's going to happen, because he, or who he really is, or where he comes from, that background. I just thought it was very interesting, because, you know, it might be total smoke, but I thought it was interesting because he acts like the same type of personality that the Templars were. Like I heard him on an interview with Alex Jones, and he said, "Look, Alex, I'm the most militaristic person there is." He said, "I'm going to help our military, help our very, I'm going to build it up so no one in the world will ever, you know, even think about crossing us in such a way." You know, okay, most people would side with that and say that's good, you know, whatever. I particularly don't agree, but again, sounds like a Templar. I mean, who's more militaristic than a Templar?
Exactly, yeah.
Those guys were hardcore, man. They were like, you know, they were like the Roman legionnaires. I mean, there's probably, to this day, no human man harder than a Roman legionnaire. So, because of what they had to go through to get to that point to even be a legionnaire. So, much less someone like the Praetorian Guard, you know, when you get into all this. So, people forget that. They don't understand what these men were, what these people were, what they stood for. And they tended to help the guy on the ground. They tended to, you know what, it seems to me, from reading everything I read about Templars, they were much like, they were like sheepdogs. It seems their personalities were like sheepdogs. And they just got super rich, super wealthy in land, with massive stores of gold. And they got too big for their britches, and the subterfuge laid against them killed most of them, but didn't kill all of them, obviously. And that might be what we're seeing here, because I just can't wrap my head around. You know, I'm not an economist, but I listen to a lot of big economists all the time, you know, and especially in the last 2 years, and I just can't wrap my head around how someone's going to stand there and tell me, after I know the vault is empty, this system is flawed beyond recognition, it's fiat beyond recognition, it can't hold, it couldn't hold years ago, much less now. So you're sitting there telling me this is all what we're going to do, everyone's going to be wealthy again, everyone's going to be moving again like it used to be, blah, 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 blah. You know, and what does he say? Trump says, and this is going to happen very quickly. And
yeah,
it's like, what?
Yeah.
How is it going to happen very quickly unless you're going to fill up Fort Knox with a whole
I suspect that it's already happening very quickly. I think that's what's going on. And it's not lost on me that we are theoretically, according to the Vatican's calendar, in a jubilee year. Now, I don't know where this Pope is. I don't know what any of that means, except we're long overdue for this system to resolve itself, which means that we have to get the debt issues straightened out. We have to bring the people out of this debt cycle. So I don't know. I mean, I'm willing to entertain optimism, and it isn't in a system and it isn't in a man, but it's in where I think we're going in terms of the wave that's come in and where everything's been trending since 2012.
Right. And I would have to suggest that it's people make it a very important part of their thinking process, their life from here on, to understand that, you know, somebody said to me the other day, or they said, oh, you know, Trump's the anti-Christ, you know, this person jumped right on the whole, as soon as he was elected, you know, it was the whole anti-Christ thing. and jumping on that and this and that. I just shut off as soon as I hear a lot of that. But and I love this guy. I really do. This person that said it, and I totally respect his opinion. He's super smart with all that Christian stuff and the earlier Christian stuff, and he understands all the lies. So, but I'm always kind of shocked when he jumps on that bandwagon, because, you know, just as easily I turn around and say, well, listen, it could also be just as easy as if my people who are called by my name, you know, repent of their ways, that I will hear their voices and I will heal their land. I said, it could be just that easy, you know, right now, is what you're seeing. Now, you got to remember, I told them, you know, there's levels to this. You know, heal your land? Eh, might be some, you know, how much healing are we talking about? You know? So as from a Jew perspective, I gotta quantify everything. All right, how much healing are we talking about? How long? for how long? Okay? Because, see, that's how I think, right? I mean, you know, like I teach people, when everybody starts talking about God, God this, God that, God's good this, which God? Ask which God. The first thing that should hit the front of your face as soon as somebody starts talking to you is ask which God are you talking about? Okay? And the same with this. It's you know, I look at it and it's, okay, it could be just that simple, that enough, the fulcrum went the other way. And he said, okay, I'm going to give you a reprieve here. I'm going to heal your land. I'm going to show you something. But you better stick with it. Because, see, when the prophet said that, he didn't give a time frame. He didn't give levels. He didn't give a time frame. If I was standing next to the prophet, he said that day, I would say, oh, listen, okay, that sounds good, but for how long? What are we talking? 2 weeks? 2 months? How long are you going to heal the land for? Got to know. Okay, but see, you're not going to know that because it's dependent on your soul. It's dependent on the collective staying there. They're riding this wave, but what I'm telling people is it's very important to acknowledge what it is. Okay, acknowledge what it is, because even if my other friend's right that, you know, he's the Antichrist and all that BS. Okay, that can only take effect if we allow it to take effect. If in other words, if we forget, like we always do, what just happened, what was done for us, we don't acknowledge it as the Creator hearing our voices collectively and healing our land for a time to a certain percentage of healing, okay, so that we can see it. It's usually going to be a lot more than you expected because he has to do it in such a way that he can walk away and say, you know, come on. I gave him the whole enchilada. I almost gave him the whole enchilada, and they still reversed. So now the hammer comes down. Now I allow to happen to them what they wish to happen to them. And you say, well, you know, not all those people who voted for Trump, all those people who are on the wave, who are changing or becoming enlightened in various levels, they didn't just turn around and say, well, now I want it to go back the other way. No, of course they didn't, but by inaction is action. In other words, so everybody needs to understand that there's a lot more going on here, and that if I am correct, and he is giving us a reprieve through a man, all right, like he did with
Cyrus,
like he did with Cyrus, the exact same thing happened. I mean, it really is amazing. The exact same history. So if he's doing that, then it's imperative that everybody understands and gets back on their knees and gives thanks that, Thank you for hearing us. Thank you for our enlightenment and help us to continue that enlightenment and drive it further. And I assure you, if everybody, you know, if people on a larger scale can just do what I've been teaching them to do, such a small thing that's very simple to do, and if they did it that enlightenment would just explode even deeper and further, and it wouldn't reverse. Then it wouldn't reverse, but, you know, you can still have your Antichrist. You can. You can still have him. You know, I won't have him. But a lot of people will. You know, and so that could still happen, too. So it could still go either way. You know, so there was this wave going on. This just happened. This just happened. I know Trump firmly believed he was going to win because what was he doing? You listen to the way he talks. He was speaking it into existence. He knows.
Yeah, he actually did. He used present tense whenever he was talking about what he was going to do. He never vacillates on that because that's how we create. We speak things
that's
into
right.
existence, and he understands that power.
He knows it. He knows it, and I knew it as soon as I heard him talking all that time. Yeah, I knew. I knew exactly what he was doing. And the little Miss Fauntleroy over there, she didn't quite believe. You know what? She didn't even believe her own rhetoric. I can tell.
No, she didn't. She ran a horrible campaign.
She didn't.
It was entitlement. And I said this in a. I did a Facebook Live the other night. I said her campaign sucked. She was surrounded by policy wonks. She didn't have a clear, articulable message. Trump made it very clear. Make America great again. You can agree or disagree on that concept and what the hell that even means. But that's how you put a message out. You don't do it by putting out 2,000-word policy statements and then going out and presuming that because you're Hillary Clinton, you're just going to be swept into office with the hand of well, not God, certainly. But, she ran a horrible campaign, and she deserved to lose on a logistical level, on a moral level. And, you know, what can I say? I was grateful for that outcome. I think if people look with different eyes at what's happening right now, they may see a different picture. Does that mean I'm blowing Donald's trumpet? Well, not exactly, but I do think there's a sea change. And I think it has a lot to do with the collective of humanity right now and what needs to happen next. Hey, Shmuel, we're bumping up on time here, and I want to give you a chance to close it out, let people know anything you want to do in closing, and don't forget to give out the website and information about the books.
Well, with all this, it should really just be remembered and understood that, you know, all this data, all these narratives, these specific data, whether it's through technology, physical, whatever, this is all being driven into your DNA so that you're like a life memory recording system, which, again, in the Soul Revolution book I show, in science, that's what they have found the DNA is. So that is being used against you. And you have to come to grips with the fact that this stuff is real, and they are using it against you, and therefore the goal must be total non-consent and non-compliance to everything, literally everything. People have to learn to just stop consenting to everything that is put in front of them on so many levels, you know. But this is DNA-based soul data manipulation is what's going on, and it's immersive, and it's multi-level, this narrative system and the structure of it within this Adam Eden matrix, as I call it in the book, and it's done during all and every individual lifetime in order to drive their system, what their goal is, ahead. Now, maybe that has been broken or really derailed within this last week, this last year, to a certain extent, and what we're talking about here might be real. So I really do think people should grasp this understanding this and really start living it and thinking about it constantly and driving it into themselves on an emotional level so that it becomes an emotional level the way a lot of other religious people believe things on an emotional level. That's why we've gotten to this point, because everything that they believed they've assimilated and integrated on such an emotional level that the impetus of their soul has been able to be projected outwards on an individual level and on also a collective level, and that helps that dark side move their plans forward because it's your consent. Again, see, it always comes back to consent as well. So, like we're seeing here, we might see a little light at the end of the tunnel with this whole thing, with Trump, I don't know, but if it is, it's only because people that don't even know it yet are becoming enlightened. Their soul's impetus is breaking out. They don't know it's breaking out. They don't even know it's their soul doing it. They think it's their mind. They think it's their logic that they're seeing. Oh, I just don't like this person, or I don't like what they're doing. I heard something I really don't like, you know, or what. These are like the childlike basic levels that people are thinking on. But really, it had to have been a much greater soul impetus that moved everyone forward to make this happen. Now, whether it continues in that positive direction, which it needs to, that is also going to be based on that. Now, will those people that help do this, that don't even know they're doing it, they'll probably return to their status quo. And that would make it reverse back, see? So then it really becomes more up to the rest of us who are understand this or are coming into understanding this. So if you're coming into understanding this, then, you know, get a move on and get understanding it and implementing it, assimilating it, implementing it, projecting it quickly, just like Donald Trump would say, do it quickly, right? So that we can offset the backsliding of those who don't even know they did it. See, Randy, that's the problem. They don't even know they did it. They think they did it with a vote. Yeah. So there's a lot going on in the background here, whether there was, you know, a coup, counter coup, there was espionage, there was on many levels the military was told to stand down by Steve Pachenik, you know, who people should go look at that and, yes, and understand why for the first time in 20 years this big CIA guy even ever showed his face for the first time, and because it was him. And they used him to do that. Why? Because everybody in the military's federal enforcement at every level, they know who he is, and they took that seriously.
You're gonna see more of that, in I will say a couple of weeks. You're gonna see some other rather high ranking military officials begin to step up. We've got a situation out at Standing Rock right now with the Native Americans and this pipeline situation. And I do have information in front of me that's going to be released it's being released now, that indicates that something very affirmative is going to come up out there as well, now that this election's over. So,
it is important that everybody take it real seriously and start maybe moving in that direction, regardless what you believed or what you've learned before. I think that's what we're doing with this series. I think that's what the book does. It really pulls all that together and gives it a more direct point of travel. It lets you understand where the head of the spear is, you know, and move forward in that direction, rather than, you know all these little points about spirituality and all this stuff. We eclectically, you know, a lot of people know all this stuff eclectically in different levels, and you know this and know that, but very few put it all together into what we've done, what I've done in this book and what we've done in this series, to really give someone direction that they can really, you know, really start walking straight on that straight and narrow. And if everybody starts doing that, you know, that is within the hearing of our voices, and that would be a tremendous help on not allowing this stuff to backslide, because those people are going to do that. They are probably going to, a lot of them, a good percentage of them, are just going to go back to their status quo thinking and just poof, unplug. And that's the problem, because that's so, you know, as far as anything else, like I said, it's a, you know, we can... there's other stuff on my, you want me to tell the website, right? The HLCblogspot.com.
Yep. People know where they can go and what they can find.
You know, stuff like that. And also just for people that are buying the books, also jump on Amazon and, you know, put some reviews up there.
Yes, absolutely. I got to do that myself.
what everybody thinks.
Okay, what's the website?
So that was the AHLC at blogspot.com.
Excellent.
And there's AHLC Global.
Yeah.
It's AHLC Global at blogspot.com.
Oh, okay. So yeah, AHLC Global. Okay, we need to correct that because I've been running in some other URL. So it's, once again, AHLC Global at blogspot.com.
I believe that's what the direct link is.
Okay. We'll straighten all that out. All this information for you YouTubers out there is underneath the video we put up. And you can find the same information on the show page at offplanetradio.com, where we also have this series in MP3 audio format for you people out there who want to take things on your phone and your iPods. That's going to close it out for this time. This is the TriUnity Series with Dr. Shmuel Asher. I'm Randy Moggins, and we'll be back in 2 weeks with another show. The truth is out there. It's inside you. Now go find it.